Hello everybody and welcome to this new appointment with the AIM Seminars. It is a great pleasure to have with us Monica Bianchini. Monica Bianchini received her master's degree cum laude in applied mathematics in 1989 and her PhD in computer science and control systems in 1995 from the University of Florence, Italy. She is currently associate professor at the Department of Information Engineering and Mathematics of the University of Siena. Monica Bianchini is a member of the Siena Artificial Intelligence Lab, CELAB, and her main research interests are in the field of machine learning, with emphasis on neural network for structured and deep learning, approximation theory, bioinformatics, and image processing. She has authored more than 130 papers and has been the editor of books and special issues on international journals in her research field. She has served and serves as associate editor for IE Transaction Neural Networks, Neurocomputing, the International Journal of Knowledge-Based and Intelligent Engineering Systems, International Journal of Computers in Healthcare, Frontiers in Genetics, and was editor of numerous books and special issues in international journals on neural networks, structural pattern recognition, and pattern bioinformatics. And now I let the floor to our guest. Thanks again, Monica.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. It is really a great pleasure for me to have been invited to the AIM Seminar Series. I'm here today to present my talk on how graph neural networks can be used effectively to address the problem of drug discovery and testing. Okay, so first of all, let me show you how my presentation will be organized. I will begin by sketching how many problems in real world involve data that are not, let me say, plain, but rather structured. That means composed of some basic entities which are related among them based on different relationships that cannot be disregarded. Then I will focus on the graph neural network model originally conceived here in Siena in 2009. At the very beginning of its history, this model did not particularly attract the interest and of the readers and of the community of artificial intelligence, which probably did not grasp the potential of GNNs, probably thinking that they were yet another architecture similar to other for structured data processing, not so different from those architectures which were just existing. Instead, mainly in the last 5 years, GNNs have undergone a great renewal of interest with a flourishing of GNN-type architectures, most of all very different from the original model, but all sharing the common characteristic of being able to process graphs in their entirety. However, today I will consider only the original model and show how it can be applied to carry out the whole process that goes from the discovery of new drugs to their evaluation and to the estimation of their side effects. Okay, currently there is a great variety of real-world problems concerning structured data processing, from those involving, as listed here, citation networks to metabolic networks, to web applications, for instance, spam detection and so on. Structured data have a hybrid nature, so they are partly symbolic and partly sub-symbolic. This is because the symbolic part of the information can be collected in labels attached to the nodes, whereas sub-symbolic information is attached to links between nodes. Before connectionist models for graph processing were devised, graphs have to be pre-processed in some way. This means they must be visited in some way in order to obtain a plain representation from them. In any case, this procedure had to be designed manually and certainly produced a great loss of information, unpredictable before just having a representation for the graph. On the other hand, if a graph can be used as it is, it can combine heterogeneous source of information organized in very, very complex networks. Okay, and now let me introduce the GNN model with some detail to understand how it can process graphs in their entirety as a whole. GNNs accept graphs as input and can return an output at each node or at each edge, or a unique output for the whole graph. We have two main types of problems that can be faced thanks to graph neural networks that are called node-focused or graph-focused. A node-focused problem is that, for example, to establish, if a certain protein belonging to a metabolic network is involved in a particular process related to a tissue-specific expression of a gene. Instead, a graph-focused problem can be think as that of devising or deciding if a molecule is mutagenic or carcinogenic or so on. In this case, this property is not a property of particular atoms, but instead of the whole graph. Here we can see, I see only a part, but here we can see a molecule of acetyl salicylic acid, which is the active principle of aspirin, which is naturally represented as a graph. And on the right-hand side of this slide, we have the corresponding graph neural network that you can see is represented as an encoding network. So we have a unit able to produce some calculus at each node. At each node V, we calculate a decision function, which can be represented by its class or by a predicted value for that node. The decision on a particular node V is made on the basis of both local and neighboring information, and in particular depends on the node label, on the labels of outgoing edges, if any, on the labels of the neighboring nodes, and on the information previously collected in the neighboring nodes, and possibly also on other types of information if present. What else? Obviously, all this information must be stored somewhere. And for this purpose, we define an internal state vector that we call X. And this vector is defined for each node. This vector is recursively calculated based on the states of the neighboring nodes evaluated at the previous time steps. The computation of the state at time t corresponds to the processing of a standard neural network, as we will see in the next slide. Since this state transition that happens at each time step is realized by a classical MLP. Also, the output at each node may be evaluated based on a different multilayer network. Here I have schematically represented what I have tried to explain in words. What is important is to note that the output at node V is evaluated based only on its state at convergence and on its label. Convergence that will happen after capital T iterations, assuming that the system, the dynamic system, which is represented by the GNN, has a stable equilibrium point. This can be ensured thanks to the Banach-Ciopoli theorem if the state transition function FW is a contraction, that is, it is Lipschitzian with constant L strictly less than 1. So, FW and GW, W stands for weight, because these are parametric functions, are both realized by MLPs, which respectively calculate the state and the output at each node. Moreover, the FW modules are locally connected in a way that resembles exactly the graph topology, as it can be seen from this picture. And all the FW modules share the same parameters, so they have the same weights, so as the GW modules. Looking at the figure in this slide, we can again notice, as I said before, how the encoding network exactly resembles the graph topology, the topology of the graph that we want to learn. Finally, here we can see how the encoding network can be unfolded in time, obtaining what it is called just the unfolding network. The unfolding occur until convergence, and the last layer of the unfolding network, as you can see, is constituted only by the GW modules, which produce the output. In the modern architecture of GNNs, normally this hypothesis is fall down. So actual GNNs are trained not until convergence, but for a certain number of iterations, and then the learning is stopped. But as I said, I will use the original model in order to describe my research. Okay, the state update equations through the entire graph form a non-linear system in the state variables that can have multiple solutions unless the condition that I said before is maintained valid. Actually, we can initialize the weights in a way that initially F represents a contraction map, but this condition must be enforced during learning, because in general the value of the weight changes significantly during learning in order to move the behavior of the network toward the solution of the problem that we want to address. So this condition that can be established at the beginning, because we can choose an ad hoc initialization for the weights, must be maintained constrained during learning. Since the state calculation proceeds for T steps until convergence, As we have seen, we can unfold the GNN, the encoding GNN, in time, obtaining what we have called the unfolding network, each layer of which corresponds to a time instant and contains a copy of all the units of the original GNN. Obviously, connections between layers depend on the GNN connectivity. Each iteration over time produces a synchronous updating of all the node states, which corresponds to one iteration of the Jacobi's algorithm for solving the nonlinear system described in an implicit form that is shown in this slide. As we have seen, for each node, a part of the state of the node, also an output vector can be calculated based on the state that converges and on the label of that node. In the case of graph-focused problems, so the problems in which we want a unique solution related to the entire structure instead of on each node, we can choose to consider a unique node as being supervised and only an output is produced at that node. This is, for instance, the case in which we have a particular structure for the graph. For instance, a graph which has a super source is typically a case in which the super source of the graph can represent a node on which the output can be calculated. Another possible situation, anyway, is that of considering the output on all the nodes and then average over all the nodes in order to obtain a unique output. This depends on the problem at hand. Okay, graph neural networks are universal approximators on graphs. Since they can approximate in probability and up to any degree of precision any function on graphs. Moreover, GNNs can be trained both inductively and transductively. This means that in the second case, okay, inductive learning is the classical one. So we have a training set. We use this training set to train the network. And after trained, we have an object that can be used to obtain predictions on unseen data that constitute altogether the test set. But in the case of transductive learning, the training patterns and their targets are used in conjunction with test patterns, and the decision on the test set is taken using a diffusion mechanism, exploiting the intuition that patterns with similar features are probably similar, and so they belong to the same class. Here we have a slightly different model for GNNs, which is called composite. Composite GNNs are actually an extension of the standard model, particularly tailored to process heterogeneous graphs, graphs which collect both nodes and relationships that could belong to different types. So we can have entities representing different objects, and we can also have links representing different relationships. The only difference with respect to the original model, the learning process is still valid, is the same. The only difference is that the GNN consists of NV state networks and one output network, where NV is just the number of different types of nodes that are present in the graph, as it can be seen in this figure. Moving on to biological data, this slide shows just a few examples of problems that GNNs can address. In fact, since molecules are typically represented by graphs which are undirected and cyclic, we can process them with GNNs, and we can establish, for instance, if a particular compound is mutagenic. Another, obviously this case is just a graph-focused problem. Another possibility is that of considering regulatory gene expression networks that can represent all the proteins that interact in order to guarantee the expression level of a particular gene. A problem that can be solved is that, for instance, of edge prediction, in order to decide if a new protein not usually belonging to a particular network can be included in order to guarantee some level of expression which is tissue specific. Finally, a last problem, strictly related to the generation of drug-like molecules, which is one of the main topics of this seminar, is the prediction of the spatial arrangement of the amino acid near in the vicinity of active sites of proteins. This is very important in order to design ad hoc drug inhibitors. In this slide, we have a complete pipeline for GNN-assisted drug discovery. In particular, we can evidence the versatility of the GNN model, since, as it is depicted here, GNNs are used to solve very different problems. First, they are used in a generative framework to generate new drug molecules, putative drug molecules. Then, che cosa succede? Ok. Then they are used to evaluate the goodness of these molecules in order to understand if they are really synthesizable. Then we have another graph neural network, actually in this case a composite graph neural network, which is able to evaluate the possible drug side effects. And finally, we have a GNN module, which is able to select the best molecules which actually become drug candidates. Okay, so now let's start with molecular graph generation. In molecular graphs, atoms correspond to atoms, and links correspond to covalent bonds. Generative algorithms for graphs are interesting by themselves because they have many potential applications, but generating new drug-like molecules is one of the most challenging. Because based on the structure of the target protein, the structure of the ligand can be modified to achieve a better arrangement, spatial arrangement, and to fit the active site. In this way, also, known drugs can be retargeted with slight modification in order to attach to different proteins. In common practice, the development and testing of a new drug is really expensive, both in time and money, because drug discovery and testing can last up to 15 years and cost hundreds of millions of dollars. Therefore, bioinformatics and AI techniques promise to reduce the work involved in this process and speeding up time and lowering cost. With this in mind, what we have done, we have recently proposed a new GNN architecture called MG2N2 for Molecular Generative Graph Neural Network, which is a sequential generative model to construct molecular graphs. Well, the generative algorithm starts from a graph composed by a unique node, which is extracted, sampled from the training set distribution. Each step is just realized as a standalone problem. So at each step, we decide if we have to add a new atom to the molecule, in which way this atom should be attached to an atom just present inside the molecule, and possibly if it must be linked to other atoms. Okay. Just have a look at this slide. Indeed, each step is divided, as I have suggested before, into three subproblems. Starting from the atom, which is considered to be the current one. So we have a list of atom that is formed step by step during the construction of the molecule. The first step has the scope of deciding whether a new atom should be attached to it, and then in what way, and whether further bonds must be added from the new atom to the molecule that we have constructed so far. For each of these subproblems, we have a dedicated GNN module, and these three GNN modules are a node classifier, the first one, because the first problem to be solved is to predict the next neighbor, for instance, here of node 3, which could be a carbon, an hydrogen, a nitrogen, an oxygen, or a fluorine, or the possibility is stop. So from this atom on, the molecule have no other atoms attached. If the answer is stop, we have to consider other atoms just present inside the molecule. Otherwise, we use an edge classifier in order to decide to predict the type of the covalent bond, single, double, or triple. And finally, we have an edge predictor in order to decide if there must be other chemical bond collecting the new, linking the new atom to the atom just present inside the molecule. Here an example is shown, a graphical example is shown, in which a new carbon atom in red is added to the molecule attached to node identified with 0 and represented with node 4 and connected with a single covalent bond both to node 0 and node 1. This is a very important question. The three GNN classifier should learn a discrete stochastic distribution. To obtain a behavior like this, we use an output layer which is constituted by the Gamble softmax, because the standard softmax is not able to produce what we want. In fact, with the Gamble softmax, we are able to classify each sample based on the posterior probability of each class CI with respect to that sample, just adding some noise, which is calculated, drawn from a Gamble distribution. In this way, what we are able to do in practice, consider this example. If I have 100 samples exactly equal one another, and we use a standard softmax, our classifier will classify all these examples in the same class, which is the one with the greatest probability. But if we use a Gamble softmax, we will assign any possible class in a percentage which is proportional to its probability. So in the example shown in this figure, we will have that an example will be assigned to class A in 10% of the situation, to class B in 60% of the situation, and to class C in 30% of the situations. The molecular graph GNN can be considered a sequential model that uses the entire information collected in the graph constructed up to the current step T in order to decide how to continue the construct at step T plus one. This iterative procedure make the construction of the graph much more interpretable, explainable with respect to construct the whole molecule at once. Another idea which is developed in this model and that is very important is that the three GNN modules in practice are trained in a standalone way, assuming that the other modules are behaving exactly as it is expected. So in this way, if I have to correct the behavior of a single module, you can leave the other unchanged. We have tested our new model on the QM9 dataset, which is a standard benchmark containing 134,000 molecules with five possible different atoms: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, and fluorine, and three bond types: single, double, triple, with the aim of generating new chemically valid molecules not found before in the dataset. In this picture, you can see from a qualitative point of view the similarity of the molecule generated by MG2N2 with respect to the original molecules contained in QM9. Okay. And now let's start facing a different problem, which is that of predicting drug side effects of drugs. Drugs side effects are a fundamental issue in drug development, in drug design, because they can be evidenced only at the end of the pipeline for defining a new drug. Moreover, the cost related to the treatment, the clinical treatment for due to DSC are increasing every year. Therefore, the prediction of drug side effect in silico in early stages of the pipeline that we have seen would allow to shorten the time from the discovery of a new drug to clinical trials. To face the side effect prediction problem with GNNs, we consider a graph which collects both drugs and genes. So, as you can understand, we will use not just a standard GNN, but instead a composite GNN, as we have to process a heterogeneous graph. On such a graph, we solve a multi-class, multi-label node classification problem applied only to drug nodes and not to gene nodes, because we want to classify drug based on their possible side effects. Being the graph heterogeneous, as I said, we have to use cGNNs. That are trained in a mixed inductive-transductive way, because in this way we exploit both the features of drugs and genes during the induction path, and we use the information on the side effects on known drugs during the transduction path in order to predict the side effect of new drugs. The whole method is flexible, since the graph dataset, which is constituted by a unique grid graph, can be extended, both adding new features to each node and adding nodes and predicting edges inside the same graph. Here we have our heterogeneous graph, in which, as you can see, we have the gene nodes represented in orange and the drug nodes represented in blue. And you can see that in the case in which we have a question mark, we don't know the drug, the side effect of the particular drug. Our architecture is called drug GNN. As it can be seen from this picture, the integration of multiple data sources was needed, together with a heavy phase of preparation of the data, to construct the graph describing the interaction between drugs and genes, and also to attach ad hoc labels to the nodes, both representing drug and genes. But as it is written here, we can actually do better, because we mainly describe drugs based on the SMILE standard way of defining a molecule. The SMILE is a ASCII sequence that is obtained in somewhere visiting the graph representing a particular drug. What we suggest to do is to avoid to use SMILE, but instead using another GNN to extract an embedding from the drug molecule. So the procedure is made in an automatic way, using a different GNN to produce a plain representation, a signature for a drug, in a way which can be tailored to the particular problem solved. In fact, we can consider a situation like this way, this one shown in the figure. We have a sort of cascaded architecture in which first we extract an embedding, a signature for each molecule, drug molecule. And then we use this extracted plane vector to be attached in the in the drug GNN graph, heterogeneous graph. But as I said, in this way, the two modules are cascaded. This means that we can optimize the embedding realized by the molecular embedding submodel in order to solve the particular problem. And now I have reached the end of my speech. And in conclusion, I just want to reiterate how maintaining relational information between basic entities is fundamental to solve the very difficult and complex problems that are typical of our real-world application. This type of data, which are really structured, are very typical in biological problems. For instance, for identifying drug target, but also in other problems that we have briefly sketched. In particular, during this talk, I demonstrated the novel MG2N2 model capable of generating drug-like molecules for drug discovery and retargeting, and the drug GNN composite architecture for estimating their side effects. This is just one a small part of the entire pipeline to design drug in silico, almost completely in silico. In the future, we think to switch to constrained generation, which will also allow the design of molecule with specific properties established a priori and whose side effects can be controlled before clinical trials. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks again, Monica. There are quite a lot of questions to this very interesting seminar. Let me try and show them. So Nicola Bologna asks, is that correct? If the input graph is of a GNN is a complete graph, then the GNN is an N or neural network?
Yes, the GNN is a neural network. If we have a complete graph, in this case, we have a FW module attached to each node. But in general, the GNN is a neural network. It's only a neural network which is really composite. And in order to obtain a standard neural network, which can be trained with an algorithm which is something similar to back propagation, we have to unfold the GNN in time.
Okay, another question by Nicola. It seems the generative algorithm simply grows a graph inductively subject to some constraints. Which are those constraints? Can the GNN yield a non-feasible solution?
Yes, it can. But in general, we try to force in some way their correct behavior. So, for instance, the predictor of the type of covalent bond is chosen in such a way to respect the law of valence with respect to the particular atom.
Okay, thanks again. Another question by Steve Adzolin. Which is the advantage of the Gamble softmax? It seems like injecting noise in the training, which might deteriorate the performances.
Probably I was not so clear. The idea of having a gamble soft max is the following. If I consider a particular sample, training sample, this sample will be classified most of all based on the class which has the greatest posterior probability with respect to that particular example. But actually, we want to have a behavior which is a little bit different. So suppose, as in the slide, to have three classes which have not the same probability. But adding noise, we force the possibility that sometimes an example can be classified in one of the class that have a posterior probability which is not the highest one, because also these class are sometimes feasible.
So yeah, it's just for adding stochasticity during the generation of diverse molecules. Yeah.
Also for this.
Again, how can you evaluate quantitatively the generation of novel and never seen molecules?
Okay, yes, of course. I have not reported the numerical results. We have used three ways to evaluate the goodness of the molecules. Just calculating that they are unique, they are novel. If you can show my...
Sure.
Yeah. So I can... It was written in the slide, but I don't put attention on it. Here. Validity, novelty, and uniqueness. So we have tested each molecule to guarantee it is a valid one. So in the case in which we have generated the molecule which is not chemically okay, we discard it. It must be novel, so it must not belong to QM9. And it must be unique because the GNN can generate many times the same molecule. So we choose only the unique one. And our model has the greatest value of VUN. We have called this metric VUN with respect to what is present in literature.
Another question by Nicola Bologno. Are there abstract properties of the sequence limiting the weak sensor, for instance, produced by GNN like the preferential attachment model?
Okay, are there abstract properties of the sequence? No, we have found no bias in the construction of the molecules, if this is the question.
Okay, and the last one, how the generation would be modified by using 3D design molecules?
Okay, how the generation would be modified?
By using 3D design molecules.
It's okay, GNN can, the representation is plain, but actually we can generate 3D graphs.
Okay.
We can also decide and predict the bond angles. We can predict all.
One other question: what about the explainability of the MG G2M2? What can you tell us about this? The fact that it's more explainable, can you detail?
More explainable because instead of constructing the molecule as a whole, we construct it step by step. So we can check if what we are constructing is, similar to what it is expected. That means that the molecule which is constructed step by step, is chemically significant, stable, synthesizable, and so on.
Okay, I believe there are no more questions, but there have been a lot. Maybe they can also be taken offline, given that the slides will be available on the site. We thank again Monica for this very, very interesting seminar. And we give the next appointment on May the 17th with the next iteration of the IIM seminars on the same site. Thanks again, Monica.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.